Morning, church.
Whoa.
Where'd that come from? It's a good day to gather and worship the Lord, isn't it? Even though it's gloomy outside, we can still count our blessings, and one of them is that we can gather in the name of the Lord and worship Him as brothers and sisters in Christ. I have a few announcements this morning. We are blessed to have Reverend Todd Zeidema here this morning to bring us a message. He's going to be speaking from the book of John, so we look forward to having you bring the message today. There will be no praise team today. Amanda's under the weather, so we'll be singing with some videos. I have to look at my list here. National Day of Prayer will be this Thursday. Program here at 7 o'clock at Living Water. So if you can join us for a time of worship and prayer for our community and our nation, that would be wonderful. Next Sunday will be our celebration Sunday. We have chosen May 5 to do our 10-year anniversary of God's faithfulness and goodness to us as a church. Living Water's mission statement is seeking to follow Jesus by loving God and loving others, and that's what we hope. That our true intention, our mission is in life. God calls us to do that, and we hope we are living that out in this community. So we will be having 10 o'clock worship next week, Sunday. Then we will have a meal afterwards, and then we plan on having a parking lot party afterwards. Weather permitting, we're going to kind of keep an eye on that, and there might be a plan B for that by next Sunday. But we look forward to everybody coming next week, Sunday, 10 o'clock worship, then a meal afterwards, and then a parking lot party with lots of games and fun. And speaking of our anniversary celebration, we have put a little video together that we would like you to watch at this time.
Happy birthday, Lindsay and Walter.
No, you don't have your hearing aids in. Happy anniversary, Living Water.
Happy birthday, Living Water.
Happy anniversary, Living Water.
Happy anniversary, Living Water.
Happy anniversary, Living Water.
I like that we can come here and worship God together. It doesn't matter who you are or where you're from. We're all part of God's family, and we're all welcome here.
I get to do crafts.
I love that Living Water is family. I love that we drive past and my kids are like, that's my church. And they get excited to come on Sundays.
Happy anniversary, Living Water.
Happy anniversary, Living Water.
I love the worship.
Going to sing songs.
What I like about Living Water is that our pastor is really good and he knows a lot of stuff about Jesus.
Definitely the pastor. He's awesome.
Pastor Jesse
does a good service for us and he will always do anything in his power to teach us about God.
Maybe being with my mom. Being with my family.
I love the way that the sermons relate to everything. I love that we love others by loving God first, and that we are inclusive, that we welcome everybody, come as you are, and that we are just going to love on you, and that we're going to walk beside you.
Happy Living Water!
Happy anniversary, Living Water!
Shaken and stirred,
can be calmed and broken from my regard. Through it all, through it all, my eyes are on you. And through it all, it is well. And through it all, my eyes are on you. And it is well with me. For me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea.
I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Grace is more. Grace is found, is where you are. Where you are, Lord, I am free. Holy name, temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Okay, so I was just informed of another announcement. If you have ordered t-shirts, they will be on Sandy's desk, on the ledge of Sandy's desk out there. If you would still like to order t-shirts, the orders have to be placed tomorrow. We are going to do greeting one another walk around at this time, and at the same time, we are going to ask the kids to come up and do the noisy offering. And then after a little bit, I'll pull us back together, back to our seats, and dismiss the kids at that time. Okay, if you'd like to find your way back to your seats, and kids, we'll dismiss you to Little Treasures at this time. And at this time, we would like to welcome Reverend Todd Zeudeman.
It's good to be here. Good morning, everybody. It's a joy to be here. Just a little bit, I thought I'd been here before, but it's been a little while, and perhaps some of you don't know who I am. Just to give you a little background of who I am and why I'm here, and just a little bit about that. So, as mentioned, my name is Todd Zeudeman, and I serve at Dort University as Director of Church Relations. What does that mean? As I told a couple people before the service, at Dort University, we think we're a better place when we have a close relationship with the local church. Knowing that certainly, on one hand, we certainly benefit when young people, as they're discerning God's call in their lives, think that Dort University would be a great place for them to continue to pursue their education, and we want to provide that, not only equipping them with the education that they need to be successful and to be able to enter into the callings that God has placed in their lives, but not only that, we want to deepen them in faith. And we talk about learning at Dort happens not only in the classroom, but it happens in the residence hall, it happens on the court or the field, it happens on a choir riser or playing an instrument. It happens just hanging out with friends. And we want to see how God is Lord over all parts of our lives. And knowing that as we continue to serve and deepen in our own faith, that God calls us to be a witness as well. And how can we do that? By sharing the love of Jesus, by displaying it in our actions, but also through our testimonies, but also in the ways that we approach the work that we've done. How do we see the people that we work with as image bearers of God? How do we know that the work that we're doing is something that God has given us to do, and we can do it with excellence, and we can do it in a way that tries to be a reflection of God's kingdom as He desires it to be? A little bit of my background, I served as a pastor for over 20 years, 6 years in West Michigan in the Grand Rapids area, and then before I came to Dort in 2020, I served just down the road west on Highway 18 in the community of Hull, where I pastored Hope CRC for a number of years. I've appreciated getting to know Pastor Jesse over the years, and I'm thankful for his work here. I'm thankful for the work here at Living Water, for the people who gather here, but also, as you mentioned, as you are an influence in the community. So thankful for that partnership. And as I pray for the churches in Northwest Iowa and the churches that play a part, a vital role in the life of Dort University, know that I pray for churches like Living Water and the churches around our area as well. Praying for, that we make much of the name of Jesus, and that as we go out and serve, we do so together as partners in the kingdom. We have the privilege, too, of being able to open God's word together. And so if you want to follow along in your own Bibles or on your devices, or if the text is going to be on the screen, going to be reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 20. And it's hard to believe, that we're only just a few weeks past Easter. But I think we should still be living with that kind of that Easter resurrection joy of knowing that the tomb is empty and that Christ is risen. That was hard for people to get their heads around, understandably. In our experience, for the most part, people who have died don't come back to life. Even though Jesus had laid down lots of, not hints, but had told them that the grave was not going to be the end, it was still hard for the disciples and the people in those earliest days to get their heads around. So I'm going to be reading on that evening after resurrection morning from John 20, and we'll be reading verses 19 through the end of the chapter. And before I read God's word, let's pray together. Lord God, we're thankful that we can live together in the knowledge that the tomb is empty and that Jesus is risen from the dead. Lord, as we understand what that means, not only for our eternity, but may we, as we read your word, understand what that means for our today as well. And so, Lord, in the reading of your word, we pray for your Holy Spirit to take the words written on these pages, inspired by you, but Lord, in that inspiration, write these words on our hearts as well. And Lord, use these words as you see fit. May they comfort us. May they challenge us. May they convict us. May they teach us, however you want to use them. But ultimately, may it be used for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, John 20, verse 19, and following through the end of the chapter. on the evening of that first day of the week when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Now, if you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. And if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Well, now Thomas, also known as Didymus, essentially meaning the twin, who was one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again. And Thomas was with them. And though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." And then Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." And then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. And blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. So we give thanks as we have read God's word together. As I mentioned, as I was introducing myself a little bit, I spent a little over 20 years pastoring churches. And in those 20 years, I spent a lot of time in hospital rooms or in the living rooms of people or in perhaps in my study or office, listening and walking with people as they were going through difficult times. One of the things that I learned to ask sometimes as I was hearing their stories and trying to discern what they wanted or needed from me by means of encouragement or guidance, I would ask them this simple question. In the middle of this hard time, whatever it was, I would ask them, So what are you learning from this? Quite often the answer, because nobody wants to go through hard times, whether it's relationship-wise or health-wise or stress at work, most people would say, "I think God is trying to teach me patience." I think that's a pretty common answer for all of us. We're in the middle of things. We want it to be done. We want it to be on the other side of it. Well, I asked that question not with some kind of prescribed answer that I expected people to have. There was no right answer for them to give. Every situation is different. Everybody responds differently to stresses and hard times. And while there might be similarities, everybody's unique. We recognize that. That's the way God has made us. The motivation for the question remains the same. When we are going through difficult times, it is an opportunity for us to learn something about ourselves. When we experience trials and hardship, when life is hard, How do we respond? If we think about this in relationship to our faith in God, how is this time, this difficult time, shaping our faith? Can we be honest with each other and say sometimes when life is hard, sometimes doubts creep in? There are times when our faith is challenged, and by God's grace, He gives us the opportunity to lean into our trust in a God who is good and a God who provides and a God who loves us, even in difficult times. And the depth of the height of the troubles that we are going through is not necessarily in direct proportion to how much God we think God loves or doesn't love us. God loves us, and His love is constant. So in the text today, we read about the disciples gathered together in that upper room that evening after the resurrection. And staying with John's account, the disciples knew something that had happened, but they were still trying to sort it out. What did it mean that this tomb was empty? They were still learning. And John is transparent too. They were afraid. For all they knew, at any moment, a group of soldiers might be pounding on their door, ready to arrest the remaining followers of Jesus and to deal with this Jesus problem once and for all. If we were somehow able to put ourselves into that same situation, we would understand that we wouldn't be very different. Can we be honest and say that we'd be afraid too? We don't like the unknown. Sometimes in the unknown, our imaginations run wild and we think of the worst possible outcome that will happen. You see, all of us have things that we're afraid of, whether we're brave enough to admit it or not. All of us, to some degree, are afraid of the unknown. As I think about this, I look out at your faces as I stand in front of churches and know that as I mention some things here in a moment, that I'm not thinking of anyone or any specific situation that you yourselves might be dealing with, but knowing as someone who has pastored churches that these are things that go on in every congregation, every gathering of believers. For some of you, the coming years and maybe the past few years have been hard, and there's no guarantee of a resolution, maybe no guarantee of a cure. You're dealing with health issues. Maybe you're wondering, what are the next steps? Or you're wondering if you've experienced some healing. It's always in the back of your mind, is it going to come back again? Or maybe there's a family member or a friend who's been making some bad choices. Maybe they've been harming themselves or others with their decisions. Maybe choices on how they've been, what they've been putting into their bodies or how they've been using their bodies, or relationships outside of the boundaries of how God calls us to live, and addictions and abuses of substances, marriages under stress. And we want it to stop, but sometimes we feel helpless and we can't do anything about it. We want to shake people until they see it. We want things to be right because nothing we've said up to this point seems to change anything. And it's like sometimes in our lives, it's like watching an accident in slow motion. We see what's going to happen, but we're powerless to stop it, it seems like. Every day, the stresses can build up. Bills that seems to pile up. A schedule where it always seems like we're running, but we're getting nowhere. We second guess our decisions. We look past all of our appointments and the demands of our time, and sometimes we just sit down and sigh and say, what is this all for anyway? Is it worth it? We wonder if when the time is going to come when we hear the knock on the door and everything is going to come to an end. We wonder if the faith that we've professed in God is going to carry us through. So much is out of our control, and we can't do anything to fix it. We feel helpless, and we get to a spot that it seems like we're paralyzed, and there's nothing that we can do to change it. And these moments literally bring us to our knees in prayer, and we pray to God, God, help me. Jesus, help me. And in the midst of this, we can feel afraid. There was a lot of unknown for the disciples that we read here in the text. There's a lot unknown for us. Now, my goal in mentioning all of this is not to kind of amplify your anxiety or fear. It's simply to name what is already there. I was listening to a podcast recently. I spent some time on the road, and the comment was this that I appreciated. It says, sometimes we come to church, and maybe a well-intentioned worship leader or something will say, you know, leave all your cares at the door and just come here and let's spend time with Jesus. And while we understand what that means and there's some merit of knowing it, really, in honesty and truth, we need to bring those troubles and problems with us into church, but lay them at the feet of Jesus and say, these are my life. This is part of what I'm dealing with. I can't just tuck them away like they're not there. And I bring them here and I lay them at your feet. Jesus, help me. I want us to leave here today with hope. We read in the text that Jesus appeared before the disciples. And he didn't just appear. It was, we read in the text, he came and he stood among them. He was physically present. And the first words that we hear Jesus say to the disciples is a word of greeting. It was an everyday greeting of that day, but it is a greeting that had some depth to it that the disciples maybe had never heard in the same way before. Jesus said, peace be with you. In those days, you would have heard Jesus say it in the language of the day. He would have said, Shalom Aleichem. Peace. Peace be unto you. Let those words be words that we hear for ourselves today. Peace. Peace be with you. You see, as we continue reading in the text, Jesus was there with them, identifiably Jesus. He showed them his hands, his side. And it says that the disciples were overjoyed to see Jesus. But that wasn't all that they felt. If you read the parallel passage in the Gospel of Luke, it says, when Jesus appeared, they were startled and frightened. They thought they were seeing a ghost. But it wasn't a ghost. They could touch him. It was Jesus in the flesh. And just as Jesus was really there, present among them, so really, Jesus could give them tangible and actual peace. Because if Jesus was truly there and the grave was empty, there is nothing that Jesus could not accomplish. Peace be with you. See my hands, see my feet. Peace. As we try to put ourselves in that room on that Sunday evening, I wonder, is it truly possible to have peace, even though we haven't yet experienced peace? Think of it this way. The war is over, but the news hasn't reached you on the front line yet. The game has been won, the victory is won, but you haven't been able to check your phone to see the update, or you haven't watched the highlights. Peace was there. Peace be with you. Death didn't win. And if death couldn't separate us, nothing can. No matter what happens, you're not alone. No matter what happens, I am with you. You see, there are many times in life where we will have moments and situations where we are afraid. Part of the Christian life is not saying, oh, we'll never have anything to be afraid of anymore. There are things that we might be afraid of because we just don't know exactly how it's going to work out, but we're still able to move forward because we have a greater hope. And knowing that what is waiting for us on the other side of the trouble we experience is far greater than anything we can imagine. You see, we can live with fear. There is healthy fear. But if we have hope, we can get through. It's when we lose hope, fear turns to terror, and terror paralyzes. You see, it is not terror that Jesus wants us to experience. We might have fears, but we can move forward in hope. Jesus is risen, and he had work for the disciples to do, even though they might have had moments of the unknown, of being afraid. But in hope, Jesus has work for us to do as well. And in that hope, be at peace. Because Jesus is risen, and he sends us to serve. It says in the text, verses 21 through 23, again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Not only do we not have to be afraid, but he also sends us out. Jesus speaks of the unity of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit united in mission. And the Father sent the Son, and the Son sends us, and the Holy Spirit empowers us to go forward. Let's think about that interesting sentence that Jesus says at the end of that little section that I just read. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven, or if you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Sometimes people read verse 23 and we might think for a moment that it's a confusing verse, but it doesn't need to be. Jesus isn't saying that we have the authority on our own merit to decide who is forgiven and who isn't. Can't take that verse by itself and not include what we've read in previous verses. As those who have been saved by Jesus Christ, we're sent by God to be his representatives in the world. And any authority that we have is to fit in with what God has already done. So we offer the promise of forgiveness, the forgiveness of Jesus, to anyone who repents and turns to him. In the same way, we do not have the authority to give the forgiveness that leads to eternal life for those who refuse to change, for those who refuse to come to Jesus. Knowing that Jesus gives us peace that overcomes all fear sits at the foundation for us to be able to overcome our doubt as well. So let's talk about that doubt a moment. We read that Thomas wasn't in the room when Jesus first appeared. When he was told by the other disciples that Jesus was alive, we might be able to understand that he was skeptical. Would we be any different? In the text we read, the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his nail marks in his hands, put my fingers where the nails were, put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Does this strike you how bold that was? Seeing the nail marks is one thing, but putting his finger into the wounds, putting his hand into Jesus' sides. You know, if someone shows up and they have a cast on their arm, I will assume that they've broken a bone. You know, I don't necessarily have to take them by that arm or that leg and give it a smack. Does that hurt? Is it really broken? If I see that they're wearing a bandage, I don't need them to remove it to show me the wound. I laughed as I thought about this. You know, there were times where I would visit people in the hospital after a major surgery, and I had one gentleman who was just kind of always laid it out there, and he says, "Yeah, it was quite a surgery. I've been in a lot of pain. You want to see?" Yeah, that was probably something that I could have taken his word for it on that one. Are there people who fake injuries? Sure. But in this case, if Thomas saw Jesus, wouldn't that have been enough? Once again, Jesus comes and stands among them. It doesn't say that he walked through a door or a wall. He was just there. Jesus, still fully human, but after the resurrection, had unleashed his full divinity to be anywhere that he chose in any way and at any time. And he said, "Peace. Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand. Put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Jesus has defeated death. He's risen. So, people of God, peace be with you. And then Thomas said to him, in his deepest, most heartfelt profession of faith, "My Lord and my God." Thomas makes his profession. He believes. Tradition, outside of the canon of Scripture, says that Thomas became one of the greatest evangelists in the early church. Primarily, he became associated with bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to what we now know as the country of India. In fact, many years ago at seminary, I had a classmate from India studying to be a pastor. His name was Thomas. He came from a long line of Christians who had believed in Jesus centuries before the gospel ever came to Europe and to my own ancestors. Thomas's ancestors believed in Jesus while my ancestors were still worshiping trees and even eating missionaries for lunch. You see, we have not yet seen, but in faith and through the testimony of Scripture, we believe. And for that, Jesus says we're blessed. Pastor Tim Keller, in one of his sermons, reminded us that if Jesus is risen and the tomb is empty, then everything changes. You have to take all of what the Bible says, not just some of it. In addition to the resurrection, we need to believe in the miracles. We have to believe in the good news. We have to believe that God's word is a guide for our lives, and that the Bible gives guidance and instruction on how we are to live. And as John closes out the chapter, he says, "These things are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." We can believe and we can have life. Even though there are times we're afraid, we know that we have a place where we can go, where you can find hope and where we can find peace. So as we read this text, and then we look around at our lives, near and far, as we look at our friendships, our families, maybe our own life, as we look at our community, as we see the state of our nation and this world, I think many Christians should be asking themselves, what am I supposed to be learning from all of this? If our answer is that all that has happened is somebody else's fault, I don't think we've learned very well. If we think that there's some kind of earthly fix that will make everything better right away, we're lying to ourselves. We're not going to find it with the right policy or with the right leader or the right government or the right weapon or whatever it is that we might come up with. We can maybe try to spread the blame. We can blame our leaders or other countries. We can blame our corrupt culture, for which we have lots of material that we can talk about. We can talk about the day-to-day immorality that has become so commonplace that sometimes it's hard for us to see it anymore. We become numb to it. There is a place for critique and to be a voice of truth to the world around us. We can do all of these things. But if we haven't started at the very beginning to take time to look at ourselves and ask, do I believe? And if I do, have I confessed my sins? Have I turned to Jesus? Have I died to my old life? And am I striving to come to new life in Christ? In my life, do I show evidence that in my words, in my actions, that I'm striving to conduct myself in a way that reflects the truth, that because of Jesus, I can have peace today, but also eternal peace for tomorrow? Are we taking time to learn from Jesus and His Word? Are we letting the Spirit speak to our hearts? Jesus challenges us to live out our faith. Jesus says to Thomas as well as the other disciples, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. If Jesus has risen from the dead, let's live like we believe it. Let's live in the way that shows that the only way to new life is through our Savior, Jesus Christ. As Jesus was present in body to give the disciples peace, Jesus sends us out into the world to live in that peace, to be a reflection of Jesus Christ, to show the world that there is a place where we can have a deeper peace, a better peace than anything that the world can offer. There is that saying sometimes at the close of a person's earthly journey, we say, rest in peace. If we think about it, that shouldn't just apply to those who have gone on before us in death. Resting in peace, in the peace of Christ, empowers and energizes the living to serve as well, because we no longer have to fear, because Christ is risen. So maybe one of the things that we take from this morning is, for a time, a short time, maybe we turn off the news for a little while. I'm all about being informed. But sometimes if that's all we surround our lives with, we have to ask ourselves, is this making me a better follower of Jesus, or just does it make me angry or afraid? Let us be daily learning that our hope and our footing is found in the gospel message, in the good news of Jesus. And then, grounded in faith, let's invest time in the people whom we love, our family, our friends, our church community, in our neighbors, and be in prayer for our nation and for our world. and pray for our leaders. And pray and support those who live lives that are especially difficult now for whatever reason. And we pray for healing for those who are sick. And let's be intentional about whose presence we seek in our lives. Remember who it is who can only give us true peace. And may we join with Thomas and may we confess together, my Lord and my God. See, Jesus calls us to more important work. We've been sent. How are you going to show people Jesus this week? As Jesus showed his hands and feet that he was truly alive, how are we going to show others the resurrected Jesus through our hands, through our words, through our presence? We've been sent. In the ways that God sends you, share the message of Jesus and let people know that there is forgiveness in Jesus' name. Jesus is truly alive. We don't have to fear. Jesus is risen from the grave. He overcomes our doubts. Jesus is alive. And so we can live in faith. And let's live like we believe it. And we have life in his name. So brothers and sisters here at Living Water, hear the words of Jesus and be sent with them. Peace. Peace be with you. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for your words of hope, of comfort, of assurance in knowing that the tomb is empty, that Jesus Christ is risen and that he is alive. Lord, may evidence of the resurrection live out in our lives. May that be an encouragement for us when we sometimes walk through dark valleys. May it be an encouragement for others as we walk beside people whom we care about who are going through difficult times. May we know that there is resurrection hope. And Lord, may we find peace. Peace eternal. Peace be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So as we go from this place today, may you have strength for today, bright hope for tomorrow. Know that Jesus is risen, and he says to you, peace be with you. And he sends us to serve wherever he leads you. Know that God walks beside you, walks with you, and his face can be shown in you in your interactions with others. We do not walk alone. And let us leave with the Lord's blessing. People of God, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. And may all of God's people say, amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.